This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com. The only place to be in your pop culture world.
Come on, come on. We call it the place to
be. The place to be, yes. It's the place to be.
Then I shall be.
Place to Be Nation, Scott Criscola and Justin Rosero. This is the Place to Be podcast.
It is contagious. It is the place to be, and we are live each and every Monday.
To do worse than Josh Richard.
Nation, welcome to the great episode of the one and only Place to Be podcast. I am your co-host, Justin Rosero, coming to you live here on this Monday evening inside PTBN Studios. And joining me, as always, my PIC, and that is Scott Criscola. Scott, how are you?
Good evening, JR. Good evening, Place to Be Nation. Welcome to episode 489 of the longest-running episodic motherfucking gold standard. You know, JR, you keep saying that, we're going to do 500 in the next century, but we are only 11 away. And you always say that it's going to be forever
October.
And forever. And
October is my prediction for 11 more episodes.
I'm going to say, you maybe you're right. I'll say Labor Day. Early September.
Maybe July or something.
Maybe before. We'll see. Depends how many times you got to go to England, Delaware. Did you play good tonight? That was a game. All was well. Did DeMarco play tonight?
No, last week he played.
Oh, last week he played.
It was a good game. It was a nail biter. I'm hurting. I'm sore. I've been drawing Colin as a matchup, and he's tough. So it's a workout.
Okay.
And of course, CrossFit Andy, played for the first time this year, and he's
It's different now. He used to just be a giant hoss. Now he's like a athletic hoss.
Yes, quite athletic.
Well, it's good to be back, JR, with you and everyone, and actually a debut joining us this evening as the third member of the team.
It is a debut. As a gentleman who, we'll let him talk about his origin story, but I believe he's been around for a while now as a fan and a listener and a participant in the group chats. But I did meet him for the very first time down in New Orleans a few weeks back for WrestleMania tailgate, the PTB tailgate. Had a great time talking, bought me a drink. It's the easy way to my heart. So therefore, when we had an opening here, Scott, I was like, you know what? Mm-hmm. This guy was articulate, well-spoken, a nice gentleman. Big time fan. Why don't we invite him on to talk a little February 1980 MSG and just break a spirit? So here we are. And that is the one and only right out of Chicagoland itself. That is Mr. Timothy Slomka. Tim, how are you?
I'm great. Yourself?
Oh, we're well. Thank you.
Good to have you on.
Well, this wasn't the January show. So thank God. I listened to that podcast. Oh. That was something else.
No, this is only moderately better. Yes. I wouldn't say it's head and shoulders better. It's moderately better.
Pete gets a real sludge. If he's on a show, you know it's going to be a terrible show.
Yeah, you know it's going to be garbage.
I haven't heard of half those guys that were on that. I mean, that's what you're going to bet.
Neither did Vince. So he booked him with his eyes closed.
Scott, this weekend, by the way, on Friday, I went to my very first full day spa experience.
I saw that.
It was my mother-in-law's birthday / Mother's Day. Got my first ever pedicure. That was an experience. I told Kelly, the nail technician, that she was my first, and she treated me well. It was 50 minutes. It felt good. Got a massage. Did some yoga. I highly recommend it if someone has the means and a nice spa nearby to take themselves a day and treat yourself, as some would say. So just wanted to throw that out there. Get a recommendation out to the world for a spa day if you have one nearby. You have any nearby you? I guess the one I went to, Scott, would be close for you.
Oh, Mohegan? Yeah, pretty much. Yes.
How about you, Tim? You ever been to a day spa or of any sort?
I've been there to work at them, but not to actually get one. Oh.
Well, you should go. You're a well-kept man. That would be nice for you.
Thanks. My wife, I had a client that had one, so my wife spent the day doing that while I worked. So I think that was a fair trade-off.
Oh. No, it would have been better if you were doing this.
That's true.
She was working.
Yeah.
Or if you're both doing it, that'd be even better.
You are well kept, unlike the other slobs that were at that tailgate. So it was good. It was nice just to see a class up the joint a little bit. A few of us at least had to carry the torch.
Thank you. We were wearing our matching WrestleMania shirts. I had a 7 and you had 8.
That's true. No, I fucked up. Was it that one or was it Graham? Did Graham have WrestleMania 8 one too? Or someone else did, right? Because then I not... Was it you that we took the picture and I had my sweatshirt on and they said you should add it off?
Yeah, you had the sweatshirt on for the picture. Didn't even think about it.
Blew it.
Yeah, that's what happens in New Orleans.
That's right.
Were you waiting for somebody to have a WrestleMania 9 t-shirt or a WrestleMania 6 t-shirt? That would have been even better.
I got a 10 one. Enough, I don't know if they make one for 9. I'm not sure what match would qualify.
Be a waste of clothing.
Doink and crush.
Be a waste of cloth.
Tend to be careful though. If we talk too much about New Orleans, Scott's going to get upset again, thinking we're hiding stuff from him. So we don't want to go down that route.
All right, no more.
Tim, I even though that you're on for the first time, I know you'll tell me the actual stories instead of these weird alluded ones that really didn't happen just because they say, you know, 6 words and giggle. So because everybody's 11, unlike Nick Duke who said everything, including losing his fucking stuff in the porta potty, which pretty much I would assume that's where he forgot everything in the porta potty.
Most likely, that's a tame Nick Duke story from that trip.
But anyway. Yeah. So Tim, you would say that you probably had half the barbecue that Pete had in his plate.
You know, I'm not the one with food. I didn't eat food all day until I got to WrestleMania, which was a terrible decision.
Right. Why would you not eat all the delicious barbecue food we had laid out for you?
It was a big mistake, and I think I ordered 4 pretzels with salt at the Super Superdome when I first got there.
Yes. That cost you, what, $50?
Yeah, because, of course, I got the cheese with it, too. So.
Oh, hey, well, that takes you way over the top there.
Yeah. What did you think of your first tailgate experience, by the way?
It was great. You know, I'm a little shy at first, so it was a little rough to get used to everyone. And then I offered you a drink, and you were saying, I'm not ready for one yet. And then 3 seconds later, you said, all right, Red Bull vodka. So you're ready to go. But, you know,
wow.
JR
pushed it to the limit, huh? There you go.
I needed it by that point.
Move that heartbeat up.
It was a rough Saturday with the rain and the cold. It made for a rough morning. But everyone was just so nice and friendly and outgoing. So I really appreciated it to be invited. Tons of fun before a long day of wrestling.
It was a long day of wrestling. It was a great time. Yeah, I needed that Red Bull and vodka pretty bad, or else I didn't know if I was going to make it the whole night. It was it was definitely a much-needed boost. I think I cleared it, though. I asked a few people, like, you think it's all right if I do this? And they're like, yeah, go for it. So I went hard with the Red Bull and vodka. I think I pounded a few before we took the greatest Uber ride of all time. Donnie Uber drove us over the Superdome. It was quite the experience. It was lap-sitting involved, Scott. So I'll let you piece together maybe who was where, but it was a good time.
Well, since you're not saying it clearly...
None.
It was all guys, obviously.
No, there were 2 girls in the car, so I'm not going
to... Oh. Yeah.
There was only 2 girls there altogether, so you can piece that part together.
Jen and Stacy, and they sat in each other's laps. I think
See,
Jen
look
said
it.
That.
You're learning more. All right.
Well, Jen said it. That I remember on the show. I do remember her saying that. So your pulse rate was already, you know, 890 over 770 if you had fucking 3 Red Bulls. Yes. So your pulse probably would have been higher in the fucking
Uber. Blood all rushed one direction for sure.
Yeah, Jesus Christ. Thank God your heart didn't explode.
So, Tim, tell us your quick origin story here as it comes to both a wrestling fan and a fan of Place to Be Nation.
Yeah, from a wrestling fan, I think I started around 1990 Survivor Series. That's the one I can most remember. Remember being excited about the egg and the mystery partner. So that's really my first memory of wrestling. I pretty much was a fan then through the Attitude till about 2001. And I went to college and it disappeared from wrestling for 4 or 5 years. And then, you know, post-college, we had the old, one of my friends, McDermott, had his old, cheer box. And it became a Sunday tradition to kind of go over there and watch the pay-per-views for free. Sorry, Vince. But I'm sure he's heard enough. But just going back there, we catch up over the weekend, you know, what had happened. And just started getting into it. And then from there, you know, we went to Mania 30, we went to 34, a bunch of us, Royal Rumble in San Antonio. We tried going to the All-In or try getting tickets to the All-In. It's a disaster story of the chat today, but, a great thing. And I get a couple shout-outs if I could do it real quick.
Yeah.
First of all, happy Mother's Day to everyone out there.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. It was a good weekend. Yeah, I was going to say that.
Thank you.
Well, for JT looked like he treated people well. And then, you know, Scott, first of all, congrats on the Main Event 100. I reached out to you, I know, a week ago or so ago, but a great listen.
Oh,
and very,
thank you.
Tough
thank
to
you,
do. Cause just doing this one time is nervous enough. I don't know how you do 100. and then, you know, real quick.
Ripple and vodka.
No, that's what you need when you listen to it.
That's because you're not on, of course.
Yeah. And then just real quick, a couple friends, Colm, Chomac, Bacon, Reardon, Bill, Mike, Spice, Dan, and then my daughter, Grace, and Kim. I'm going to give them shout-outs real quick, and I'll tag them in so they can join in. So that's kind of my wrestling background. You know, I'd say I'm a moderate fan. Pretty much followed WWE only, but in, you know, the mid-90s, followed a lot of WCW as they kind of picked up steam, especially through the NWO, and kind of fell off at the same time everyone else. 1998, I think, is my stopping points, which pretty much the rest of the world jumped off there, too. And then place to be for you guys, I used to travel a lot for work, so I was always trying to find podcasts and things to listen while I stayed at an airport for, you know, 6 hours missing flights, and followed you guys about WrestleMania 6. Or so, and pretty much listened, you know, waiting every week for a new podcast as I sat at an airport alone. And then since I didn't listen to the Attitude, I kind of stopped listening there, but really listened to a lot of your live watches. And, you know, you guys had like the WrestleMania Rewind series. And then I love that you guys went back to 85 because you kind of mentioned it on the 23 podcast. But, you know, really, you guys really had a great history of the early stuff. And really, I'm enjoying these MSG shows and, you know, a little more background into WrestleMania 3 because I wasn't really a fan back then.
Cool. Well, no, it's a great story. We appreciate you, of course, being such a long-time listener, and hopefully,
absolutely,
not just a one and done here. We'll mix you in. I was also waiting for you to shout out Terry Tyrell, Jaden Jeremiah, back in Minneapolis there too. For Jesse Ventura, callback.
No, Chicago people only. Sorry.
Okay. All right, Scott. Why don't we go ahead and get started?
All right, as you mentioned, JR, tonight we head into the back to our home office. The date is February 22nd, 1988. We're again back in our office on 33rd Street, otherwise known as Madison Square Garden. Our final MSG show, JR, before WrestleMania 4. We won't be back in the building until April 25th. So, the last time we were in this building, as we just mentioned, was a real drizzler.
Yeah.
And this one may be slightly better, but depends on your point of view. I feel it was a very experimental show that Vince put on tonight, and I'll get more into that as the show progresses. The only show on this night, there were three shows last night on Sunday the 21st. There were three shows, and one of them, JR, was in your building, the Providence Civic Center. The others, they did a matinee evening show up in the Pacific Northwest. They were in a venue in Billings, Montana.
Jesus.
And then they were in they were at the Tacoma Dome in Tacoma. And I'm not going to get into the whole card, but two matches on the show in Tacoma, very good. Ricky Steamboat and Rick Rude had a Royal Rumble rematch that went to a 30-minute draw. And then the main event of that show, listen to this, it was Randy Savage and Strikeforce taking on the Honky Tonk Man and the Hart Foundation in a 6-man tag cage match.
Wow.
So that's kind of cool. That was the main event in Tacoma the night before. But on this evening, this is the only show, which again begs a question where most people are. But I have, unlike January, which I think was a lot of scrambling, I think this was more designed, but I'll explain later.
I think I've seen that match before. I wonder if they fought somewhere in like a bigger arena. I feel like I had
maybe
that
in
match.
Boston.
Yeah, I feel like I've seen that one before. Like, wait, remember like in the when I was in Connecticut, I remember like when we used to like find some matches. I don't know if they were either downloaded or we had like some DVDs we had traded or some shit.
Yeah,
like, I remember
you're
that
right.
Match being on one of them.
I'll look it up. Maybe they were in Boston on the 9th. Maybe they did it then.
Yeah.
Let me see. I don't think it'd be on a Superstars or anything.
No.
Any of it, this is not a sellout, actually. And Graham mentions that on the – Graham Cawthon mentions that on the history of WWE.com, a rare non-sellout for the Garden on a Monday night in February. Kind of odd. Gorilla Monsoon is back, JR. Gorilla back from his medical hiatus from his heart attack. And with Lord Alfred. And what else do we have? Any other details and facts and figures?
Since the last time we were televised, the main event on 2-5, covered that last week, on the 2-6 Superstars, during a match featuring the One-Man Gang, Jason Ventura spoke with President Donald Trump on the phone regarding the seating arrangements for WrestleMania 4. After the bout, Ventura left the booth in protest after a note was sent to the commentary table from Jack Tunney, saying that Tunney was about to have a statement regarding the main event. Ventura was censored throughout the telecast whenever he attempted to talk about Hogan versus Andre. Also on 2-6 at house shows in Boston, Philadelphia, Ted DiBiase came to the ring wearing the WWF World Title belt and was introduced as the new champion as a result of what had happened the night before. DiBiase teamed with Andre the Giant versus Hulk Hogan and Bam Bam Bigelow at both locations. A week later on Superstars, Jack Tunney announced the WWF World Title had been vacated as a result of what happened, and a new champion would be determined on a 14-man at a 14-man tournament at WrestleMania 4 at Trump Plaza. On 2/20, Superstars, the first WrestleMania 4 report aired. The British Bulldogs and Coco Beware versus the Islanders and Bobby Heenan and Brutus Beefcake versus Honky were announced, including the announcement that Bob Uecker would be the guest ring announcer as well. So stuff's starting to come into scope, into shape here for WrestleMania 4 as we edge toward that big night. And, of course, that brings us to tonight in MSG as Gorilla and Lord Al welcome us in and set the stage for the night ahead. That brings us to our opener, and that is the Fabulous Rougeau Brothers taking on King Harley Race and Iron Mike Sharp. A very bizarre match. And Greeny tells us Sharp is subbing for Hercules, which makes sense because it would have been the Heenan Family Guys. But it makes Race look like a super fucking jobber here. Very weird.
Oh, yeah,
match.
Big time. It doesn't bring up Iron Mike Sharp. It kind of drags down Harley.
Oh, yeah. He looks like the guy, you know, when they had like tag matches and like, in like 91 or 92, it would be like Coco and like Red Tyler. You know what I mean? Like it was just like one decent guy and one bum. You know, you get that a lot. Or like Brooklyn Brawler and then, you know, just like a no name. So like they kind of have one guy or even like Brunzel or Jim Powers did a lot of those teams.
Yep.
So that guy would like never take the fall. Usually the straight jobber would. That's what it feels like with Race here. Is he feels like he's tumbling down the card a bit. The Rougeaus really need a refresh too. They're spinning their wheels pretty badly. Bobby leads out this mishmash team, demands the fans bow to the king. The crowd fires up a weasel chant as things settle down. We open up with Race and Jacques. Sharp wastes no time getting involved. The Rougeaus wipe out both men with drop kicks. We reset. Jacques goes to work on the king. Race tags out. The Rougeaus pick on Sharp for a bit, focusing on his leg. Iron Mike is able to lure Jacques to the corner as Race lands a blow, but Jacques shrugs it off, and the Rougeaus keep banging on the leg. Gorilla plugs WrestleMania 4, says it's coming soon, and Donald Trump doing a great job promoting it. A lot of fake news out there around the show. Race comes in, turns the tide as Gorilla reveals that the WWF title will be up for grabs in a tournament. Race hits a nice pile driver for two, tags in Sharp, who clubs away. Race and Sharp take turns on offense, with Jacques grabbing desperation shots here and there, but can't put enough together for a comeback. Sharp eventually whiffs on an elbow. Ray gets the hot tag and cleans house, gets a sleeper on Iron Mike. Race makes a save. Things break down until Race gets dumped outside. The Rougeaus hit Le Bomb to a huge pop for the win. I thought this was all right. It chugged along, cut a decent pace. I like Sharp as the fall guy to protect Race, despite this disaster of a team. Glad it didn't overstay its welcome either. They kind of hit the high points and gut out. So I want a star and a half on this. I thought there was enough there to make it probably better than the standard opener we deal with on these shows, Scott.
Yeah, I gave this a star and a half as well. I felt bad for Hurley, but I guess he's at this point now where, you know, this is what he's meant to do. Your match time is 9:26. So before I get to my comments, it looks like the first time I see this six-man cage we were just talking about, I actually saw it live. It was at the New Haven Coliseum on February 9th is the first time I see it. The next night, it was at the Mid-Hudson Civic Center in Poughkeepsie. So maybe that was on it. Maybe it was on a tape.
No,
then it was on
it was
again.
Definitely, it was like a just like a rip of like a match off online or something.
Interesting. February 11th in Lake Placid.
It was never in Boston or Philly or anything?
It was in Springfield on the 13th.
I don't know.
Cap Center in Landover. Although Graham doesn't. Well, Graham doesn't mention that it's a cage match, but it might have been.
Hmm. Was that televised?
It doesn't say it was televised. No. Altoona, Omaha. I'm just looking at the cities that are leading up to us. Columbia, Missouri. Rosemont.
All right. It's all right. Nope. Give your thoughts.
Wichita, Kansas. Yeah, I'll have to think about it. But anyway, interesting. Alfred, again, loves to use the word supple. He just puts it anywhere. He used to say that, you know, Lanny Poffo was supple. Now he says, these boys need to be warmed up. They're very supple and warm. This from a guy who doesn't know what the term genuflect means. Did you notice that? Like, here's a guy who's supposed to be royalty and everything, and he's trying to ask, he asks Gorilla, what does genuflect mean? The stupidest thing I've ever
I meant to look up the origin of that. I swore that's like an English word or an English term. I just, it was crazy when he said it. It was the first thing I wrote down.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
I didn't know what the word was.
I know, it's so bizarre. He's such a moron sometimes, Alfred. As you said, JR, as you mentioned, it had already happened on syndicated TV, but here Gorilla officially talks about the tournament mm-hmm. on March 27th and the matchups, which Fink gets into later. Decent MSG fair. Like I said, Tim, nothing to write home about, but I agree that like everybody in this match needs something different, particularly the Rougeaus, which is funny because the tag division isn't quite as loaded as I found it.
It was Boston March 5th. It was actually on the greatest steel cage matches ever. Oh, this is a tape or a DVD. It's the old tape with Hogan on the front.
Oh, okay.
It was in Boston.
So it happened at...
Yeah, they went 8:20.
So it happened after this. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, that makes sense. I remember seeing it live. I went to a house show at the Coliseum. I remember seeing it live. It was pretty cool. Anyway, Tim. It's... Considering that the tag division's not quite loaded yet, as it would be, say, 10 months from now or whatever, your thoughts on the match, and then your thoughts again on the Rougeaus, and do they need anything right now?
Yeah, I gave it a 2. I thought the Rougeaus actually got the crowd pretty into it. There were some loud weasel chants that they were getting going. But it's weird. They were wrestling like heels, like going behind the ref's back, not making tags. They also had no music, so their pop coming out was really weird. So I think you're kind of right about it. Felt like they were almost like trying their heel act on a weaker team. But I thought they got the crowd into it when they actually were just, getting in a chin lock or Race was working them. You know, they would pout on the mat, get the weasel chant going, bothered Bobby. You know, I thought it was actually pretty good. When I first watched this whole thing, I messaged JT halfway through it. I said, I'm going to have to redo all my notes because I just have negative stuff about Lord Hayes the entire time. So I've crossed some of them out. I had the Jenny Fleck comments, and then he had something about the Iron Mike Sharp wouldn't know what a king or a queen was. And I again, didn't quite understand that. So that must have been some inside jab at him. But he's just all over the place. It seemed – you kind of mentioned it. Gorilla's talking about WrestleMania 4, and – Alfred Hayes has just no clues what's going on with the storylines. He could barely get out what Trump was talking about, and it was just kind of all over the place. I thought once they brought Bobby in, I think it really picked up moving angles along and then just moving matches along. Mm-hmm. But like I said, I think a 2 for that for an opener compared to, like you said, it wasn't 19 minutes. It was pretty fast paced, and their finisher is one of the best I've ever seen. I can't believe no one's like stolen that because it's one of the rare finishers you see. You know, where both guys are doing something, right?
Right.
The one guy gets the celebrates the pin, and the other guy does the flip from the cover. I'm shocked no one's stolen things like that to kind of get both people involved.
No, it is a pretty cool move. It's funny because I don't remember, I guess unless you were really watching like syndicated TV at this point, like you probably didn't see it a lot because I don't remember them hitting it in too many big matches. Usually it's just like, I guess maybe the squashes and stuff, they would really showcase it, or maybe around the circuit. But on like, I don't think we've seen it that many times, Scott. Maybe WrestleMania 3, I think they might have done it. But
right.
Yeah, so. All right, so there you go. This is your opener. The King slumming it. Lord Al doesn't know what Jenny Fleck mean. Sharp is Canadian, too. He should know what a king and queen is, right? I mean, they're...
I know, that was...
It had to be
that was just bizarre.
Right?
Yeah, I mean, it was just so strange. Like, the whole thing was a shit show. It really was.
He's calling him dumb, I guess. I don't know. For a guy that didn't know
what
a
king and a queen is. Whoa!
Yeah. All right. All right, and speaking of dumb, up next is our next match, and that is George Animal Steele taking on Sika, former Samoan, wild Samoan. So much of those good feelings in the opener. The crowd seemed to care about Steele, I guess, but I just really don't. Sika's not much higher on the ladder at this point. He stomps at Steele when he gets every time he gets near the ring. The animal just stands around on the floor looking stupid. They do that for a bit until Sika gets tangled with the ref. Steele comes in, slugs him back to the floor. Sika pulls him out, and they brawl on the floor where Sika slings him into the ring bell. Steele can't get in the ring as Sika keeps kicking him out while Al says the animal is angry. Steele chucks some chairs in the ring and slides in. Sika tries to hit Steele with a chair, but Animal dodges it, and it bounces off the buckle and back to Sika's face. And Steele covers for the win. This is just fuck it. Just a sloppy, stupid mess. Both guys have nothing going on. Steele needs to just go away soon. Sika can go with him, too. He's about done. But I can at least tolerate him as like a jobber to the stars. But Steele's just should not be winning matches. I don't give a fuck if he's a legend. If he's, I'm just done watching him altogether. So a dud. I would have went lower if we went lower. But dud as it is. Tim, what do you think of this?
I wrote done on my paper right when before the match even started once I saw the graphic. But I actually gave it a one for being sort of short. You know what? I think they kept the crowd into it. I think the placement of it wasn't great. Right?
It shouldn't have been on the card at all. That would have been my placement.
Well, you sometimes need those, you know, matches somewhere in there to let everyone get a beer or get souvenirs and stuff. And just after the Rougeau's match, it really didn't pick up anywhere, right? You know, maybe after the JYD match when the crowd was going crazy. So I kind of felt they got, you know, hammered there, but I thought the crowd was actually pretty into it, maybe just because it was starting and there hadn't been bad stuff yet. So I only gave it for one. And also, the chair shot that Sika pins himself on was horrendous. It was almost like Adonis from WrestleMania 3 with the scissors. Very similar. And isn't his gimmick he lost? It was baffling, but did give one.
God, you might as well have had Pete back on here.
I have the word on some other matches, don't worry.
Wow. Your match is 49. I guess Tim wanted it to be like 249, apparently. I gave it a dud. This is trash. And the whole thing with breaking Alfred's headset, the whole thing's just shit. Again, Mika at least is acknowledged as a jobber, and that's his job now. He's making a little extra cash. But still treat George Steele as like some kind of novelty when clearly the company is graduated from crap like that. Just makes it worse. There's nothing more to say. This is fucking garbage. And I'm pretty sure this is it for him. I don't think we see him anymore. Well,
at four.
He's in the battle.
Sort of.
Yeah, that's true.
In a battle royal. He never enters the ring.
And he might be around a little bit more into 88, too, I think. I don't know, we'll see.
I'm sure. Maybe he'll become the next Sika. Anyway, it's a dud. Move on.
This is Tim's first five-star match, so we're good.
You said you were going to mix me in, and I guess I've lost it already.
Yeah.
Keep bringing Pete back, and he gives like 4 or 5 stars of these garbage matches.
And you only ate half the barbecue he did, so if any.
All right. Next, we have another odd match, and that is Ken Patera taking on Axe of Demolition. Bobby, as Tim mentioned earlier, joins the boys on commentaries. Mr. Fuji leads out Axe for his rare singles match. Gorilla says he's surprised the Fuji would split these guys up tonight, but Bobby thinks he's sending a sign. Gorilla thinks it's a mistake doing this in advance of WrestleMania 4 in their big title match with Strikeforce. Excuse me. Patera and his shiny, creamy legs power out to the Olympic theme as Gorilla mentions that the Winter Olympics is ongoing. Bobby shit talks the U.S. performance in the games. Bobby says his jewelry and Rolex is a payment from Ted DiBiase. Gorilla says he may want that money back after what happened. Axe bails to dodge Patera, then heads back in as we get going. Patera works the arms. Gorilla says the Heenan family failed in running Kenny out of the WWF. Fuji jabs Patera with his cane, which draws Ken out and allows Axe to clobber him from behind. Axe slugs away, but Ken runs him into the post and the barricade. Back inside, Patera kept control, landing strikes until he runs into a boot on a charge. Fuji lands another cane shot, but Axe misses a falling headbutt. Patera fires up and unloads a flurry as Axe stooges around. Ken lands a clothesline and hooks in the full Nelson, but Fuji gets on the apron. Ken lets go to slug him. Ken then comes back and gets it again, but Smash shows up. Ken breaks again and level Smash, but Axe hits him from behind to get the win. Fuji comes in as well. They all three beat down Ken to booing until JYD shows up and makes a save with his chain. This is actually a fine match with some decent brawling. I like the nifty heel finish. Ken, you know, Ken's looked pretty good in these matches. He's still moving around well. It takes a lot of offense. I remember him kind of being shitty, but I've actually enjoyed him since his return, Scott. Axe stooging ground was neat, too, because we don't see it too often. And it had pretty good heat. So I went 2 stars on this, and I've actually enjoyed Ken Patera way more than I ever expected to so far since his return in 87. He's had some feisty little matches.
Your match time, 7:27. I gave this 2 stars actually as well. We do hear the debut, at least the MSG debut. I don't know if I'm sure it's been played on the Cindies, but we hear the debut of the iconic official Demolition theme. So that was pretty cool. Gorilla announces also on this night that Demolition will challenge Strikeforce for the tag team titles at WrestleMania 4. I mean, Patera's a stiff, but he has been moderately better than... I mean, I would take Ken Patera over George Steele at least. But what's funny is
he's shown like good energy. I thought like he's kind of I don't know. I've just enjoyed his matches and he's got
yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think the funny part is Gorilla's in that weird mode again where he's defending stuff he has no business defending. Like, he's talking about, like, foreign objects and stuff, and Gorilla's, and Bobby's like, well, Ken Patera has on this arm thing that's actually got a piece of metal showing, and that's not a weapon? You're a mountain of misinformation.
He's not going to use it.
Yeah, of course he's not going to use it.
He's done his time. Trust him.
He's done his time.
He's reformed. He's rehabbed.
Exactly. And you can't disqualify someone. And Bobby's right again. He's like, oh, he should have been disqualified the minute he hopped on the apron. And Bobby goes, no, he doesn't. He didn't get in the ring. And as a matter of fact, Patera hit him first. So, no, he shouldn't get disqualified. Like, I don't know what Bobby what Gorilla and Alfred's problem was tonight, but they were a fucking mess. I mean, they made no sense at all. And Gorilla was back in that, like, defending the baby faces, even though it makes no fucking sense mode. You know, the minute he got on the apron, he should have been disqualified. Why? He didn't do anything. Patera attacked him first. You can't disqualify somebody outside the ring. He's not in the ring yet. So even when Bobby tries to make sense, Gorilla just has to go the whole kayfabe route, and sometimes it just makes him look stupid. But I will agree with you, JR, and I'm curious your thoughts, Tim. Ken Patera, who we just make fun of because he's got lousy hair and terrible legs, but he's actually hasn't been too bad maneuvering since he's been back.
No, I agree. I agree with you guys. Two stars. So I matched there. So as much as I love George Steele, get back to a normal grade. I agree. I thought good energy from both of them for kind of a slog fest, but, you know, got some moves in there. You know, X is more of a beatdown guy, and I think Ken held up with him. His hair is ridiculous. I just wrote most gross on there. I don't know how you guys have no award for worst hair.
You know, that's a good one, Scott. You know, we should have probably been a lot of bad hair. We should have been tracking that. I mean, we could start it tonight, the Patera Award.
Yeah, he's on TV. I mean, I'm not going to – it just looks ridiculous. JT, you know, they said the devious one, Mr. Fuji out there, I thought he actually was doing some things out there. He had the cane. He kind of was, tripped up.
I wish I'd do that drink in your face, Slomka. I really did.
Well, the next match, he fell asleep during. So my next note is cancel that after the next match. But he actually did something in this match. But, you know, what was interesting, too, when they called him out, they yelled out Mr. Fuji first, and they got, you know, massive boos. And then when the demolition music hit, it got a pop. So right. It was kind of interesting. I don't know if they did that on purpose to kind of see what the reaction would be, but they definitely got a positive pop. But there was massive boos for Mr. Fuji out there.
They all know he sucks. Yeah,
they all know he sucks. Two stars, and then I think even at the end, you know, they kind of built up the second match because I didn't understand what was happening when why was JYD out there? But he got a massive pop, and it did kind of set up the next match. So I think that kind of worked out pretty well from a two matches in a row. I think they actually did pretty well. And the other thing is, and I got this in the Duggan match, but this ref, Gorilla, is just all over him. I don't know what his name is, but he was relentless on him in this match, and then the Duggan match was a disaster.
Yes.
I'm not sure who that ref is, but Gorilla must have some vendetta against him.
It's amazing all Gorilla's vendettas just come out in the comedy
yes.
match.
Yeah, exactly. I've seen that guy before, but I don't know his name.
I don't remember
who
it was.
I was trying to look online.
Yeah. Not remember who it was either.
No, he does the Duggan match, and he was a train wreck there. So.
It's not the fat guy with the blonde hair, is it?
It's him.
Yeah.
He did the first match, too.
I forget his name, but yeah, he does suck. He's always a fucking mess.
I have him in the first match, just stars, but what is he doing? I mean, and then he got this match, of course, where he's missing Fuji hitting with the cane, and then the Duggan match was, like I said, a disaster. We'll get to that dub later.
Yeah, that guy's always, he's always awful, and I think he's around until, like, the 90s, too, and Gorillas.
Yeah,
always
he
always
is.
All over him, yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So, like Tim hinted at, that end of that match does bring us right into this one because we actually pick up where we left off. As Smash is taking on the Junkyard Dog, and we don't even really end. We just keep going. JYD gets a huge pop, and I like the way it was set up because it kind of added to the heat. So I thought it was shrewd to have JYD come out. The brawl's going on, and then boom, right into the match. Heenan rips on Patera as Smash unloads on JYD with right hands. The Dog turns the tide, eventually headbutts Smash to the floor, where Patera kicks him. Smash returns, and JYD lands a few shots, but whiffs on a charge to the corner. Smash goes to work with heavy strikes. Bobby puts over Smash's power as he works the neck vise. The two wipe each other out with a double clothesline, but Axe trips up JYD as he hits the ropes. Patera does the same, tripping up Smash, and that leads to Axe and Patera brawling on the floor. And with the ref tied up, JYD grabs a chain and wallops Smash for the win in huge pop. garbage match, but actually the finish was pretty hot. But I am shocked that they had Smash lose to fucking Junkyard Dog here. I mean, I guess it was a little bit underhanded, and it made for a good moment, good payback for earlier. But still, you know, Demolition is going to a pretty big match at WrestleMania. Having JYD win here, I just would have had JYD hit him with the chain and get DQ'd, and then they run them off. Like, that probably would have been okay. It was just an odd choice to have any Demolition at all show any ass, especially guys just,
right,
just tumbling this far down the card. But so I went half a star for this, not as good as the previous match. Fuji sucks still, Tim.
Yeah, he was missing at the end. I didn't understand. He was just standing there while JYD's whacking Smash in the face with the chain, and Fuji just stands there doing nothing. Terrible. I gave it a star and a half. I thought the pop was huge. You know, you kind of mentioned, you know, why did JYD win? But, you know, going into the break, you know, obviously it was an intermission after this. So they obviously wanted something hot with the intermission. So I think that's probably why he won. Is my guess. Don't send everyone, you know, to the bathrooms and to the merchandise lines pissed off. And maybe as you kind of were talking about it, you know, with WrestleMania 4, wasn't JYD the third guy left in there? So I think maybe they were still treating him as keeping him hot for that. I know he kind of falls apart after that, but and he's not great in the ring, and his gut is ridiculous. But I think maybe that's why, you know, they're kind of giving him a win. And it was kind of a cheap win as you think about it.
Your match time is 3:44. I gave it a half star. JYD, of course, is subbing for the probably now departed Billy Jerkanes, according to Mr. Nelson. Billy Jerkanes. He's pretty much subbed out. He's gone. So, yeah, I was totally befuddled as to why Smash had to take a pin here. It made no sense. We've been talking the whole time about how JYD's been, you know, pushed down the card as more baby faces are taking control, and he gets a win here. It's really stupid. I don't get it. I don't know if it's supposed to – the whole false sense of security thing going into WrestleMania, them getting a tag title shot. I don't know. It seemed very strange. I mean, it was probably just for a cheap pop, like you said, to go into the intermission. But still, to sacrifice, you know, your number one contender tag team or one half of them just was very, very odd. The match was
– Yeah, I think – Yeah, Scott, sorry. I think you were kind of right on that. It's just to get a cheap pop out of somebody, but you didn't need Smash to lose before WrestleMania.
No, it made no sense.
Really weird.
Yeah.
No, it made no sense. I think JYD should have gotten DQ'd for for using the chain. They would have got the pop anyway, and then Smash could have won.
They could have beat him down after and run them off.
Yeah, that's all they could have done. So, anyway, JYD wins, and for really no reason whatsoever. So.
This card, though, definitely shows, like, some of the deadwood. And, you know, I think we'll see it happen, but some of the deadwood that could really use to be cleared out here, like a Steele, JYD. I mean, I love, like, Race has been great since he came in the late 86, but even he's kind of aimed. Like, to some of this old guard that's really cluttering up the card right now, they could really use a refreshing of the roster. I think we're seeing that pretty well displayed here on this show. To some of these guys that are just aimlessly moving, you know, hanging around, taking up spots that just old and need to be cleared out. So
I confirm.
But we'll see. All right, Craig DeGeorge is with Dino Bravo and Frenchie Martin, who rambles in French about their match tonight. Dino brags about his weightlifting and gives a fuck about either of them. DeGeorge then talks to Jake Roberts, who talks about his attitude in the ring and what's to come later on. DeGeorge then talks to Bam Bam Bigelow and Oliver Humperdinck. They're excited to be here tonight for this big time match. Calls Ted DiBiase out for using his money, causing issues, and the score will be settled tonight. Bigelow says he's in his backyard here at MSG. Two more here. Duggan's with DeGeorge with Jim Duggan, who he calls the Ho Man, which made me laugh. Duggan's all fired up to battle Outlaw Ron Bass. Says the 2x4 won't be far behind him tonight. And then finally, DeGeorge is with Slick to talk about the huge tag match this evening. His boys will outclass their opponents. He calls out Billy Graham, too. He says he's in the convalescent center yet again. And he calls them so dumb that they got hit by parked cars. So Slick on his game, as always, as was the Ho Man. That made me laugh quite a bit. This picture Duggan is like the Godfather, you know? Tell the fucking
house. Well, I had one note on Duggan. Well, he was definitely drunk or high or something during the thing. His eyes never opened. He also called Ron Bass the Cowboy. Barely could correct himself. And he dropped his 2x4, I don't know if you saw it, and then as he's leaving for the interview, asked where it was, even though it was clearly right at his feet. So he was a disaster through that interview.
I'll get used to that for the next 6 years.
Hopefully it was pre-taped at some level. And
I hope
go,
so.
Hopefully he didn't go wrestle right after it.
Well, a 17-minute match might later on in the card might have been the same. So.
Actually, was this one? Was it this one or our last one, Scott, that was pre-recorded? Wasn't there one they said it was like pre-recorded?
This one had it on the messaging.
Yeah, I thought it was this one.
It kept saying pre-recorded, so I'm not sure.
Yeah, because you know what, too? You know, we mentioned the pops, and I meant to call that. I think I call that out later. I'm really wondering how much they were sweetening this one because the crowd seemed like super. You mentioned it wasn't even sold out, Scott, and the crowd is like super energetic through most of it. And then like maybe that promo was filmed like out of order and they put it here. You know what I'm saying? Like so he was drunk,
right?
Because yeah, if it was pre-recorded, that would make a lot of sense given how just how jacked the crowd was for a lot of this garbage. That's my working theory is that it was audio sweetening. I'm looking at Graham's site real quick here to see when this was. He has it as, he has it on that day though.
No, I don't think, I think it was live.
It said pre-recorded though. Tim's right. I thought it was.
Multiple times.
Yeah.
I have it written here. Cause it was, I had to go back and say, wait, what was that again in the screen? You know, it flashed like red.
What day of the week was this? Do we know?
It was a Monday.
Monday.
All right. So it's not like it would have been a matinee. Oh, actually, was it, President's Day maybe? Or whatever the fuck it would have been then, Lincoln's birthday.
You know, I was just thinking that you might be right. Maybe it was a matinee and they aired rushed it through an edit. That's possible.
Yeah. Let's see. I'm curious if it was a holiday. Because it might have been. And then let's see. February 22nd, 1988. What was the holiday back there? When did President's Day become a thing? It was after that, right?
Yeah, it was after that. Lincoln's birthday was usually the later one. Washington's birthday was the earlier one in February.
Yeah, it was because Washington was actually born on February 22nd. So let me start.
Oh, okay.
President's Day officially Washington's birthday in the U.S. is a federal holiday. It never occurs on February 22nd. So maybe not. Actually, no, it was the week before.
Weird. Because it does seem like the crowd has hopped up. And Graham clearly says there's less than 10,000 in the building, so.
Yeah, and it definitely said pre-recorded. So, I mean, Graham may just not have realized it was pre-recorded, you know, when he did this. So, I don't know. But anyway, whatever it is. I guess it could have even just aired, like, later at night or something. Who knows? Well, I guess it could have happened on February 22nd, but aired a different day.
That's entirely possible, too.
Yeah.
Because he just has televised on the MSG Network.
Right.
I mean, so not maybe it that
aired,
day.
But, yeah, maybe it aired, like, a couple days later. Anyway, I think there's some sweetening. Just because the pops alone, and you'll see it here too. So, all right. So our next match is Jake Roberts against Dino Bravo. Random match here as Jake continues to float aimlessly, saddled with a sluggish Bravo tonight. Frenchie makes Fink remind the fans of Bravo's world record, and nobody cares. Jake gets a huge pop as he saunters out with his sack. Bobby talks about taking a tour of France of late as Jake messes with Dino to get things rolling. Gorilla talks some shit on Jesse Ventura lying about helping Dino Bravo during his big weightlifting, a record-breaking appearance as Bravo chucks Roberts over the top. Chucks him with a hip toss. Jake starts to work the arm as the debate over the weightlifting rules continues. The crowd fires up a DDT chant, and Bravo is all flummoxed. Bravo drops his head on a whip and eats a knee, but slips out of a DDT attempt to regroup with Frenchie. Jake keeps working the arm and messing with Bravo, which the crowd is eating up. Bravo eventually lands a couple of shots, but Jake battles right back and sends him scurrying. After a flurry, he returns but gets knocked right back out again as Dino has just been all out of sorts. Jake heads out and unloads on Bravo and shoves him back in before stalking Frenchie, who runs away like a giant pussy. Dino levels Jake as he slides in and finally takes control, landing a pile driver and playing to the crowd, which Al and Gorilla chastise. Gorilla gets Dino grabs a rear chin lock and starts to work the neck with power strikes, trying for near falls where he can. Bravo controls for a while, working in and out of the chin lock as the crowd is rallying Jake, who eventually turns the tide with some right hands, and the crowd starts to go bananas as he hits a short clothesline. Dino blocks a DDT. Frenchie trips up Jake, but the snake recovers and punch away. We get a sunset flip for two as the bell rings for a time limit draw. Jake beats on Dino after the announcement and then takes down Frenchie with Damien. Bravo and Frenchie scamper off as Al giggles like a little bitch schoolgirl. And that was a rare draw that caught me off guard, actually. I didn't feel it coming. And actually, you know, for Bravo, it wasn't bad. The opening stretch was fun. The comeback was hot. Bravo's heat was bland but fine. And the crowd was super hot the whole way. Again, probably sweetened a little bit, especially at the end. Jake is mega over, though, and as usual, fuck Frenchie. I went 2 stars here.
Your official time according to Graham, was not a full 20 minutes, but they weren't off by a lot. 1923. Of all the guys that they would put Jake in a draw with, they put this fucking guy. I tried to get into it. I gave it a star and a half. It seemed like that chin lock was about 16 of the 19 minutes.
Yeah.
It was just so long and this was drudgery. It really was. And the fact the crowd is hot over this, there had to have been some type of editing, because this is just horrendous. I mean, Jake's legitimately over, but Bravo, like, no one gives a shit. No one really does. And it is really – it's starting to get concerning now that – I mean, Gorilla's obviously understands what's going on, but Alfred really looks like he does, like, zero research for these shows now. Like, he really has no fucking idea what the hell's going on. It's really bad. And his bland, generic analysis isn't even making sense now. So when you could kind of – when you watch, like, the 79-80 All-Star Wrestlings and Bruno gives those, like, kind of generic thoughts on wrestlers, it's Bruno, so you kind of go with it. But when Alfred's trying to do these generic analyses of matches and stuff when he has no idea of the backstory, and he's not even right doing that, it's really bad. And usually the commentary, Tim, can cover a lousy match. But this is not doing it. I don't know what their problem. I mean, obviously, Gorilla's been out for a while, so he's got to get his feet back in the game. But Alfred's been around, and it's a mess.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of these matches that are kind of mace on mace that you can maybe add a half a star to, you can't because the commentary is so bad.
Yeah, you're kind of mentioning on Gorilla, but I thought he was keeping up with the storylines. I had in the last match that he had four different things for WrestleMania. Four that he talked about: the tag title, the Jailbird, world title, Hercules chains broken. Like it was like him and Bobby went into a pre-production meeting, were told storylines, and Lord Hayes wasn't invited. It was just nonsense. And though I will give Lord Hayes, when Dino went for the headlock again, he said they should go for something more devastating. So he was clearly getting bored with the match on his own.
Right.
You know what? I was listening to this on headphones, and there was a boring chant that started for a little bit. So I think you might be right on this crowd sweetening, because you could hear it, but it never took off. And it was during a chin lock. So there's no way that would not caught steam compared to some of the other boring chants I've heard on some of these MSG shows. So I feel like they must have drowned it out, but just didn't get all the recording out of it. But I gave it one star, all because of Jake and the DDT. So over. Every mm-hmm. time he went for it, the crowd popped loud, you know, whether it was sweet or not, but you could see it in the front couple rows, people getting up and cheering. And it was maybe interesting, it was, even though the crowd was kind of into it, maybe if it led to, I kind of said, Rude and Roberts, you know, they have that kind of boring draw at 15. I wonder if they're maybe prepping Jake for it, kind of laying out the match right here, because it's very similar, right? He keeps going for the DDT. You know, it's very similar. A lot of headlocks, gets out of them and goes for the DDT. It's kind of a similar match. So I was kind of wondering that. And then you kind of said at the end. I mean, Hayes was giggling like a schoolgirl when the snake came out. He was dying. He's terrible. I don't understand it. it's very frustrating, especially when I thought Bobby was so good on the night. And you just, Lord Hayes, like, he just didn't seem to know what was going on.
Like, yeah, he Scott was giggling quite a bit with that. He loved that snake.
I was giggling too, just because I listened to him giggle. It was quite funny. But like I said, one star, all for Jake and all for the DDT as a move. Just so over.
Yeah, no, that's a good point with the, you know, getting Jake ready for this kind of match, kind of a dry run maybe. Because, yeah, no, there are a lot of similarities. So I don't know if they would have booked maybe that far out yet, but maybe they could have.
Interesting.
All right.
Anyway, yeah, why don't we take a break? So far, JR, maybe a slight thumbs up from from last month so far. A little bit. At least we know everybody.
Yeah, we don't have anything like last month had a lot of bad crap. Like this one, we're just kind of in the middle. You know, there's like nothing great, but it's all like a
right.
1 to 2 star stretch other than the Steele stuff. So we're not really like bottoming out, but we're not really having much here to get us excited yet.
Yeah, I don't know. What do you think, Tim, so far?
Yeah, I'd say about the same. You know, kind of some average matches, but you know everyone. There's been some big pops. But like you said, we know everyone. Compared to the last week, it was pretty rough.
Yeah, well, you gave George Steele a 1 star, so this is like WrestleMania 3 to you so far. So when we We'll take a break when we come back. We've got more great matches. But first, these words. Fresh new break. Because 6 in the a.m. all day I'm P-I-M-P. I am simply attached to the track like simply. It's simply good. Young hope, infinitely hope.
Promotional consideration paid for by the following.
Hey, pro wrestling announcer Kevin Kelly here. I want to make sure you are all subscribed to all the great feeds here at Place to Be Nation. It's really easy to do. Just head to iTunes or your preferred podcatcher app today and search and subscribe to the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed, which, of course, includes the full archives of the Kevin Kelly Show, the Place to Be Nation pod feed, and the Pro Wrestling Only feed. Subscribe, listen, and then rate us and leave feedback today. And be sure to give Justin your true thoughts. I mean, don't hold back. After all, he is kind of a jerk. Just listen to Scott.
Place for Nations, JT Rosero and Chad Campbell here. We want to let you know that we have a ton of great podcasts available to you on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and PlaceforNation.com. We offer them to you on two great feeds. On the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed, we bring you the Mothership, the Place to Be podcast, along with Main Event, Survey Says, the Monday Night Wars, and our monthly pay-per-view reaction show, as well as Jeff Learns Wrestling. In addition to these full-length shows, we also deliver special network podcasts and pod blasts on topics old and new.
Over on the Pro Wrestling Only feed, we dive deep inside the wrestling business with a stacked army of experts leading the way. The feed features potpourri shows such as This Week in Wrestling, Greetings from Allentown, Match of the Week podcasts, and the Military Industrial Suplex. We also have shows that focus intently on certain topics like Through the Years, Worldcast, Strong Style History, Strong Style Story, and Mount Olympus. Plus, the feed has the full archives of legendary shows like Titans of Wrestling, Where the Big Boys Play, Letters from Center Stage, and Letters from Kayfabe, plus much more. And on our very popular Place to Be Nation Pop podcast feed, we offer such great shows as Talking Pop, the Glenn Butler Podcast Hour Spectacular, NBA Team, PTBN Play, Sunday Groove, Breaking Balls, and Lucha Undead,
as well as a veritable podcast heaven for comics fans
with the hard-traveling fanboys, Sellers Points, Todd Weber's Conversations, Geek and Sassy, and Marvel Age Podcasts.
You can find all of these current shows, plus archives of our past podcasts, including The Kevin Kelly Show, as well by subscribing to both feeds on iTunes. And while there, be sure to rate and leave feedback today. All these shows, plus others, available at PlaceFanation.com, where we cover pro wrestling, sports, movies, comics, plus in-depth stretch projects, and more. Be sure to support our site by using PlaceFanation.com/Amazon when doing your online shopping, and download our free PTB Vintage Vault Refresh eBooks via the links on our site. We also want to thank our friends at Boneheads Wing Bar in West Warwick, Rhode Island, in Fall River, Massachusetts, and TheHistoryOfWrestling.com. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr as well. PlaceFanation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Christopher Daniels. I'm a national treasure, an idol to millions, and I've got the rear that makes the girls cheer. And you're listening to the Place to Be podcast. Please continue, because I'm great and so are you.
Nation, we're back taking a look at the February 1988 house show. We're throwing allegations of crowd sweetening here. Maybe if we can get Bix and Deadspin on the case, maybe they can go and you know, tap into the audio, listen a little deep, and run a story on this thing. But I think we're onto something, guys. I think we, you know, we got Tim running the audio through the headphones or picking up on chants. I think there's something going on here tonight on this show. Scott, though, you mentioned basketball earlier, and of course, it's always great to get out of the winter, get into the spring weather, play some basketball, even though my allergies have been a fucking train wreck here. I think a lot of people seem to be hurting. Like, even my dad had to finally go to the doctor, and he never has allergy issues, so it seems to be affecting a lot of people. Are you getting bothered by it?
A little bit, yeah. I mean, I really, the only thing I'm allergic to is mold, and obviously we went from, like, kind of a wet April, and we really, you know, winter really didn't totally go away. It kind of gradually went into spring, so, yeah, no, it's definitely kicking in a little bit. How about you, Tim?
Sorry, yeah.
Were you having an allergy attack right now?
Usually. My nickname in college was Booger because of how bad my allergies and sneezing were. So, yeah, it's been rough. A lot of Claritin, a lot of Kleenex every day of my life. So,
Scott, you know what?
Were you in Lambda Lambda? Were you in the Tri-Lambs? With Latrell and... that was a Revenge of the Nerds joke. Movie can't be that old.
No, but you are. Do you know the tip for mold, Scott? You should toast your bread.
Really?
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff out there around how the foods you eat can. I don't know if you're as an allergy guy, Tim. I don't know if you're in on this, but as different foods you eat can counteract or can act in unison with various allergens. For mold, I know for sure bread is a big one. Cheese, like if you eat like block cheese or like aged cheddar cheese or whatever, can make it worse. Mold, alcohol. So if you drink beer, you may notice your allergies get worse if you're allergic to mold. Bread's a big one, though. You should toast all your bread. Don't eat just regular bread. It'll make your allergies worse if you're allergic to mold.
Interesting.
Yeah. So I don't know if do you get stuffy when you drink beer?
Yes, I do. I do, actually, sometimes.
There you go.
Interesting.
Mold allergy. See, you learn something every day here at the Police Beat Podcast.
There you go. Perfect.
All right. So as the seasons do change, though, Scott, that brings us to our pop culture corner here tonight, and that is the number one song in the nation here this evening, Exposé with Seasons Change. I'm curious what the top songs are going to be, because last week I thought was one of our best top tens as far as popular songs go. So I'm excited to see what tonight has to bring.
Well, it's actually not too bad. It's not too bad here either, JR, as we go to the number one song in the country, Exposé and Seasons Change. At number two, the Pet Shop Boys with legendary British singer Dusty Springfield with What Have I Done to Deserve This. At number three, still our Pete's Mall girl, Tiffany, with Could Have Been. George Michael at number four with another great hit from Faith, being Father Figure.
Could Have Been a restraining order if Tiffany saw Pete in the mall.
Yes, with his little sheriff star on. At number five, in my opinion, the theme to Jeff Learns Wrestling, and that's Hungry Eyes from Dirty Dancing. There you go. Number six, Say You Will by Foreigner, making a big comeback. First big hit in a few years for them. Number seven, the other big song from Dirty Dancing, She's Like the Wind, the third hit from the movie.
It's Christopher Patrick Cross, Sweet. Right?
No,
she's like
Patrick
the
Lee.
Wind. Da, 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 da.
No, that's you're getting your. Come on, man. You of all people.
No,
you
I know.
That.
I'm just kidding. It's a joke. It's Ride Like the Wind. I'm aware.
You can't joke with the cross, man. Don't you feel like? And you know what's really good is Yacht Rock should be coming back fairly soon, right? Oh, usually Memorial Day weekend, right?
Yeah. I mean, I get it.
Well, I mean, fires up on the main channels. I mean,
yeah. Oh yeah. Usually right after Memorial Day. Shout out though to Johnny D'Amato, who got me a beautiful Yacht Rock review T-shirt when he went to the concert. So he delivered that to me last week when he came for basketball.
Oh, very nice.
I love it.
Excellent. Yeah, excellent. At number eight, we get a little Rickroll. We knew this was coming eventually. Rick Astley, Never Gonna Give You Up. So the Place Me podcast has been Rickrolled. Number nine, Don't Shed a Tear by Paul Carrick. He was the guy in Squeeze and Mike and the Mechanics. And at number 10, I Want to Be Your Man by Roger, which is what he tells you every day. So there's your number one, Seasons Change by Exposé. That was the top 10 Billboard list from the previous Saturday, February 20th, 1988.
She's like the wind.
She's speaking of the wind and hair blowing through the wind, JR, only one movie came out on Friday. And... It ends up becoming a very popular Broadway musical. The movie is Hairspray.
I want to see Mark Claire's hair blowing through the wind.
Oh, I think it should be a hair blowing off between Mark Claire and Graham Cawthon.
A hair blowing off. There you go.
Hair blowing off.
In Baltimore, Maryland, in the year 1962, Tracy Turnblad and her best friend Penny Pingleton auditioned for the Corny Collins Show, a popular Baltimore teenage dance show. Penny's too nervous and stumbles over her answers, and another girl, Nadine, is cut for being black. show has a Negro Day on the last Thursday of every month. Straight out of RSV, apparently. However, despite being overweight, Tracy is a strong enough dancer to become a regular on the show, infuriating the show's reigning queen, Amber Von Tussel, a mean, privileged, beautiful high school classmate who racist parents Velma and Franklin Von Tussel own Tilted Acres Amusement Park and have banned African Americans from going there. Quit the movie. Starring, of course, Ricky Lake, Divine, Debbie Harry, Sonny Bono, Frank Costanza, Jerry Stiller, Leslie Ann Powers, Mink Stoll, Doug Roberts, John Walters. Oh, sorry, John Waters.
John Waters directed it.
Yeah.
Rick Ocasek from The Cars. Jerry Stiller was in it, too.
That's what I said, Frank Costanza.
Oh, Frank Costanza. Okay. Just want to make sure. I thought there was actually a guy named Frank Costanza in it. That would have been even better. So there you go. There's your one movie that came out that previous Friday.
Clayton Princess, Seaweed Stubbs.
Seaweed Stubbs. All right. In the NBA on that day, there were five games in the NBA. I was checking to see if the Knicks were home because maybe that's what they did. But actually, the Knicks were on the road. They were in Boston actually playing the Celtics. And Larry Bird had the high of the day in the NBA with 36. He also had 14 rebounds. But the Knicks hung in because the Celtics only won by two, 95-93. No, Mr. Slomka, your Bulls were not in action on this evening. The Celtics do still lead the Atlantic at 37-16. Hawks lead the Central at 31-19. The Pistons are a half game out. Your Bulls are three out. Mavericks lead the Midwest at 34-17. And the Lakers lead the Pacific with the best record in the league at 42-9.
Tim, quick thoughts on Chris Dunn?
I know that's your hero now. the Bulls have just been rough for the past couple of years. I think it's good to bring him in, but I think they're still a few years away.
Yeah,
it's rough. So I'm not sure if he's a placeholder or part of the solution. I'm not really sure what the solution is, to be honest. They kind of blew it up and didn't really have a plan. So we'll see.
Your AP top 10 would come out the next day, and we were talking about weird teams, JR, that don't hit that kind of thing now. Temple is your number one team in the country. How about that?
Wow.
Two through 10 is Purdue, Arizona, Oklahoma, Duke, Pittsburgh, BYU, UNLV, North Carolina, and Michigan are your top 10 for the moment. And finally, in the NHL, only one game on the docket in the NHL. That was the North Stars beating the Maple Leafs 4-2. Red Wings lead the Norris with 70 points. Flames, Mr. Nelson's Flames, lead the Smythe with 77 points. Bruins have gone ahead of the Canadiens by a point with 75 in the Adams, and the Flyers lead the Patrick by 69. And Mr. Slomka, your Blackhawks are in third in the Norris with 54 points. And that is your pop culture report, JR. Okay. Back to the garden for the Sweetened Sounds.
Yes, the Sweetened Sounds are our next match, and it's a big one. Is Bam Bam Bigelow taking on former world champion, Ted DiBiase. As Virgil and DiBiase come out to a loud chorus of boos, Bigelow and Humper did come out to stand back for some reason, which I thought was pretty funny, but the crowd I wonder if they were planning to use it for him, because soon he's got the saxes. Like, I think WrestleMania 4, he's got, like, the generic saxophone music, so maybe they were just trying it out. They figured they wrote this brilliant song. They should use it for somebody, I guess. But, yeah, so he's using it here. And the crowd's just going batty for this whole show, like we mentioned. DiBiase rants about having the title strip, but gloats that Hogan isn't champion either. Talks about WrestleMania 4. Bigelow attacks both DiBiase and Virgil, then batters Ted until he goes flying to the floor. DiBiase returns and lays in some offense as we get more WrestleMania talk, but Bigelow comes back with a hard clothesline and some punches. Ted bails to regroup again and then slides back in and catches Bammer with a knee. Gorilla talks about Bigelow's lack of experience as DiBiase pelts him. Bammer comes back with a hard shoulder block, follows an atomic drop, slaps Renzi across the face, and then Ted eats a boot on a charge, but Virgil trips up Bigelow to cut him off. Ted chokes and slugs away before dropping Bigelow with a clothesline to the neck. Ted follows with another hard shot that sends Bigelow flipping over to the top and hard to the floor. Heenan says Oliver Humperdinck is a peculiar-looking man, which I thought was funny. As Bigelow climbs back in, Ted keeps control, working a chin lock for a bit, stomping away until Bigelow breaks free, batters Ted in the corner, smacks Tony, and then Bigelow keeps overpowering Ted, but Virgil blocks Bigelow from attempting his slingshot splash. Things go outside where Ted shoves Bigelow to the ring post, and Bammer gets counted out. DiBiase wins the match. I thought this was pretty fun. A lot of energy, the invested crowd. Bigelow looked great. Ted led him step for step, and the match was fine, too. We continue to establish Virgil's role. It protected both guys. It was a fresh matchup. I went 2.5. I never really hit that next gear, but it was pretty fun, especially on a night like this where we're kind of desperate for something like that. So 2.5 for me, Timothy.
Yeah, I gave it a 3, and what I thought was interesting was DiBiase seat. Now, again, we got some crowd sweeting in there, but the pre-match promo, I mean, that was perfect.
Yes.
I mean, he just killed it, and I thought they probably should have done that, this exact match at Mania 4 in the second round, right, and kind of have him do that.
Right.
You know, cheer egging on the crowd, because, you know, that's kind of a dead crowd there. I think that would just got so much heat compared to kind of a bland match with Morocco. But I gave it three stars. Again, I think he did all night long. I might have to go back to my MVP. You know, the match ends and he gives a quick handshake to DiBiase and Virgil as they walk out. So just, you know, playing the role perfectly as a, you know, swarmy heel manager. I don't know how you guys felt on the match, but I thought it was pretty well and good after intermission to get the – oh, I guess there was a match before, but, you know, got the crowd really into it after that long draw.
Your match time is 11:04, so not too bad. I enjoyed the match. I thought it was good. Ted is in a groove. I think his pops are legit. I don't think heel pops, I should say, are legit. Bigelow was still pretty over. You know, he was a guy that could have gotten maybe an upset special and was hot, and maybe a guy that could have been a possible favorite in the tournament. Never know.
I think he's definitely a dark horse. Like,
yeah.
After, you know, who are the top four? Hogan, DiBiase, Andre, Savage. I mean, Bigelow's probably fifth if you look at the guys in the tournament. So I think he's probably the lead dark horse.
Steamboat.
Yeah, Steamboat, too, is probably in the periphery. I would say Bigelow, to me, is like the number one dark horse out of the top. If you take off those top four, I think he's right there as far as the best chance of maybe a guy they might want to skyrocket to the top and give him the belt.
Right.
So, yeah, no, I think he's – I think you're right, Scott. I think he's in the mix.
Yeah, and he looked he looked pretty good tonight. Obviously, DiBiase slightly hotter, and that's fine. And, you know, he's – I think this is what I mentioned earlier about experimental kind of booking tonight. Whereas in January, we didn't have a lot of our stars because of probably weather purposes, night after the Rumble. Maybe there was weather in Canada. On this night, I think Vince legitimately gave a lot of the big guys the night off.
Mm-hmm.
The night off. And let some other guys kind of roll with the main event stuff. And I think DiBiase was one of them. I think he was.
Yeah.
I think Vince was testing to see if he's the next to Andre probably right now, the biggest heel in the company. And I think he was trying to test the waters with him as the guy.
You can look at it as a test for Bigelow, too. Like, I mean,
yeah, absolutely.
One
sure.
of the top faces along with Jake. I guess you could maybe throw Jake with the dark horse level with Bigelow. I think even Jake over Steamboat. Steamboat really hasn't done too much. I mean, I think he's always a threat, but I would say Bigelow, Jake were the next two in line for me.
Yeah. But I definitely I definitely agree with you about Bigelow. And I think that DiBiase was getting kind of some heel shine here with no Andre here. DiBiase had a chance to shine on his own, Tim. Overall, I thought it was a good match.
Agreed.
Did I get my thing? I gave it 2.5 stars, just like you, JR. 2.5, Tim.
All right. Craig DeGeorge talks to DiBiase. He says, I should have been a DQ. Ted shushes him and says he won the match. It doesn't matter how. Everyone has a price, and Bigelow was out of his class. And that brings us to our next match, and that is Hacksaw Jim Duggan, the Ho Man, taking on Outlaw Ron Bass.
Stupid.
Another Haas Power Brawl on tap. Bass jaws with the fans and Gorilla as usual. As he enters and stomps around the ring, Hacksaw gets a huge pop as he bangs his way out. Lots of hoes, too. Duggan attacks at the bell, goes for the kill, but Bass bails to regroup. Bass returns and gets more of the same and clotheslined right back out. Bass throws a chair in the ring, but Hacksaw catches it and has a seat as the crowd's going crazy. We get started again with some rights from Hacksaw and then an elbow that sends Bass back out. Duggan follows out and shoves Bass to the post, and after some stalling, gets going back again. Duggan goes to the arms. Al says, Hacksaw has no game plan and is a bit lost. He just uses force. Duggan keeps pounding away and going for covers as Bass is totally staggered. Things spill outside again where Bass takes over and starts to club away in and out of the ring. Al calls Bass relentless. He lands a pile driver for two, chokes away, and goes to an abdominal stretch. Duggan breaks free, can't turn things around as Bass keeps working him over. Duggan finally powers up and starts to unload with hard blows and a big shoulder block. Duggan goes to a chin lock, but Bass leverages him to the floor. They stalk around. And then back in, Duggan drops him with a shoulder block and more punches. But Bass grabs the whip and chokes Hacksaw right in front of the ref, who doesn't call for a DQ. Like you mentioned earlier, Tim, a disaster. Duggan grabs his 2x4, but Bass is back to choking with the whip again. Bass throws the ref, and we still get no bell. Duggan then grabs the board, smacks Bass with it to break free, and we finally get the bell for a double countout. Fine enough brawl that kept chugging along. The crowd, of course, fired up, whether it was real or fake. It added to the match. The finish was weird, but not a shock that it protected both of these guys. I liked it. It had some energy. It stood out on this card especially. I think if you stick this on a hotter card, it probably feels like more like trash. But on this card, it added some energy to it. I actually went 2 stars on this. I thought it was a decent little brawl. What'd you think, Scott?
I also gave this 2 stars. Your official match time, 15:16. That's a lot of fucking time. I mean, this was fine. I mean, Duggan, you know, a lot of punching, kicking, and eye gouging. But for these two guys, I guess that's fine. And again, I think it's another case where Duggan, kind of a new fresh baby face for the company, less than a year here, barely a year here. I think Vince was also giving him kind of his own stage for the show. And of course, you know, we get the first of many what would be legendary Duggan snot rockets hanging out of his beard. Because he's a fucking disgusting pig. But I thought the match was fine, Tim. Decent power match. Nothing ridiculous. And I don't think this was as sweetened as some of the others. The crowd, I think, legitimately is into Duggan. So I had no problem with it. I don't think there's anything sweetened in that way. Maybe a little bit, but not as much as maybe earlier in the show, because I think Duggan is kind of over. But other than that, just a typical, you know, straight-up power match.
Yeah, Scott, maybe I was trying to warm to you, but I gave this a dud.
Jesus Christ.
It's the length, right? I mean, Duggan was over. Yeah. He had the crowd into it. They did the chair toss. They missed the camera angle, but I guess he caught it. They set it on there. But, you know, there was 6 minutes left, and Gorilla says they're out of gas already. And they went 6 more minutes, just sludge, both soaked. And then Lord Hayes again. He says the ref, this is not one of the premium refs. And then like 10 seconds later, which I'm guessing Gorilla told him, he said, to make sure he's a good ref, but not a premium one. So I'm guessing they didn't like him shitting on the ref. And then the end of the – I thought the end was terrible. I don't know, maybe because I don't follow Ron Bass as much. But you got two guys cheating in the ring, and you don't have Duggan and just go over kind of clean. And then you just have them both walk out to a countout kind of to silence. I don't know. I think – a better ending and a little bit shorter might have been better.
Oh, definitely shorter.
I mean, that's kind of what we're done on that one. Like I said, the first 5 minutes, Hacksaw had the crowd, you know, all over him. I think it was perfect. And like you said, this one maybe didn't have the sweetening of it because he was playing for pops, but just a lot of they couldn't even punch each other, and the commentary didn't help him out. I don't think when you're bashing on the ref and bashing at the guys out of gas, I don't think that really helps your product much. And weird, I don't know if you guys heard, but I couldn't figure out where Heenan went. He just disappeared. He wasn't on this match, so they didn't really say goodbye to him.
Right.
Did you guys – I don't remember hearing him on this match. Was he or
– No, I mean, I didn't have him in my notes at all. He's not managing the main either. I don't think he comes out for the main, so.
And they didn't really say goodbye or – you know, usually you thought maybe they ran him off or something. I think he might have added to it, but I just think – again, when you got the commentators bashing the match, it's not really making it interesting. And I'm pretty sure Lord Hayes got a talking to, because when he said what about the ref not being a premium one, and then a 10-second pause and then corrected himself, I think Vince or someone was at ear said, you just can't do that. So.
Yeah.
Which is funny, because Gorilla shits on the refs all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, that's true. Well, he called out this guy a lot, but maybe because they wanted to hold up the finish, maybe. I'm not sure, but... again, I went done. And you know what? Their thing is another draw, and you just had a draw a few minutes ago.
That's true.
Right? 10 minutes before that. You know, I think that's what I was kind of talking
And you had
about
a count out the match before, too. So it's like, right. There's a lot of shit finishes altogether tonight.
Right. And that's what I was kind of talking about the Steele match. Maybe if you kind of slid that in here, to kind of just switch things up a little bit, give them the win after DiBiase, maybe that match looks a little better than I know the dud you guys gave it and the 5 stars I gave it.
That still looks like shit, probably. But yeah, I mean, maybe. You know, maybe because of the length, they could have just put this a little bit earlier. But yeah, it's the whole crowd, the whole card structure is a little bit weird tonight.
Yeah, it's just you kind of like the ebbs and flows. You have the first four all pins, and then you got a draw, count out, draw. You know, it just kind of doesn't add to much. You kind of lose the chance of a pinfall, maybe. But I was trying to warm up to Scott. I know it's Duggan's boy, so.
I was being fair in this one. I mean, I didn't really need to see the up close snot rocket, but
there you go. You guys can have a fucking threesome.
There
enjoy
you
yourselves. All right. Craig the George is with Ron Bass, who says things aren't over. Duggan wins the title at WrestleMania. He'll be first in line. Yeah, I'm sure that's the big post-Mania program coming up. Duggan, Bass, the world title feud. Bass and Miss Betsy will reign supreme. Duggan comes flying in, which I thought was kind of cool, and chases Bass off and then rants about what happened. So I did like that. All right, main event time.
He shoved him hard.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, he
shoved him hard, too.
Yeah.
All right, main event time. It's a pretty unique tag match here as King Kong Bundy and the Natural Butch Reed take on the Ultimate Warrior and Don Morocco. Very random match. Slick leads out the team of hosses. Gorilla wonders where the big man's been hiding. Where's Bundy been? Haven't seen him in a while. And he actually looks like he's grown his hair out a bit, which I thought was interesting. Gorilla says Bundy's dropped some weight, but it's still very nasty. Warrior and Morocco charge out with lots of fire to Wild Pop with some rock music playing them out. Warrior and Morocco attack as soon as they hit the ring and beat on both guys cleaning house. Slick is ranting at ringside as Morocco slings Reed back inside with a double team. Gorilla wonders if Morocco and Warrior will be a full-time team, and Al hopes so, putting over their strengths as a unit. Gorilla does say Morocco is taking Warrior under his wing to teach him some experience. And we settle into Morocco and Reed, but after the natural struggles, he tags in Bundy. Slick bitches about the ref losing control and calls their opponents two morons. Bundy gets whipped into natural, knocking him hard to the floor. Warrior tags in and works the arm and then tags Morocco, and the tide turns. Bundy lands some shots and tags natural, but Morocco quickly comes back and rattles Butch in the corner. Gorilla reminds us what Reed and gang did to Billy Graham, and Morocco wants revenge. Reed fends off the attack and starts to kick away and traps Don in the corner, but Bundy gets in the mix as well and uses his size to lean on Don, wearing him down and mixing in some chin locks as well. The natural comes in with a neck breaker for two and keeps pounding away. Al thinks if they were a more cohesive team, they would have won by now. Morocco catches Reed with a shot, but he can't make the tag. Bundy comes in and chokes away, and a moment later, the two collide in the middle of the ring, and Warrior gets a hot tag. Things break down, and all four brawl with Warrior and Morocco getting whipped into each other. The ref tries to get Reed out, and that allows Warrior to get a crossbody on Bundy over a schoolboy by Morocco for the win and big pop. This was sloppy and all over the place, not much beyond some simple brawling. The ref, again, was a mess, especially at the end. Big win for the faces. Warrior's working his way up the ladder. Morocco is a steady force in the upper mid-card, and Bundy's officially cooked. This is the last we see of him for quite a while. And Reed is circling the drain quickly as well. So, again, maybe another guy that could be flushed out here soon. I went a star and a half on this last match of the evening, Tim.
I went a half star. They kind of mentioned it. It's kind of a weird tag team. When they started the night, they kind of said, oh, Morocco and Warrior are fighting each other. But they didn't mention who they were fighting. I wonder if this was like a replacement match. I can't remember on Graham's if he had someone subbing. But it was kind of interesting that they didn't say who the main event was against. So it's kind of a weird pairing, like you kind of mentioned. And I've also never seen the spot where the two faces actually run into each other in the corner. You know, I don't know what they call that, but you know, they always reverse. It's always the reversal.
Right. Yeah, that caught me off guard. I was surprised.
I had to rewatch it to see because they both have blue trunks on. You know, Warren and Morocco. So I think that was because it led right into the finish. So the finish was kind of out of nowhere too. But like I said, a half star Warriors. Crazy over the crowd again when his music hits. There was a big pop for him, and it wasn't terrible, but I think just kind of more random, and they didn't really build up the heels at all.
I give this 2 stars. I didn't think it was that bad. A test of Warrior to carry a main event. He's in the main event of the show, which is pretty interesting. Crowd's hot for them. And this is where I was saying earlier about experimenting. I think that unlike the January house show where I think, again, weather problems and other, you know, variables led to a lot of the guys not being there, I think this was purposely built to give a lot of the big players the night off. I think Bundy, I think Andre was given the night off. I think Hogan, Savage, I think a lot of these guys who wrestled the night before were given off. And I think you're going to see a lot of that in the house shows over the coming month. So I think this was a chance for Vince to kind of give some of these up-and-coming baby faces and heels a chance to kind of have their own stage and give them a test, see how they can handle themselves in a big atmosphere. And I think Warrior in particular was given the benefit of this by being in the main event. And I thought it was a solid enough match. I have to say I'm going to miss Bundy. I actually really enjoyed his run.
Yeah.
he was a guy that I think we all kind of just assume was just, you know, one of Heenan's, you know, big dudes and had a match here and a match there. But he's always been really good. He's had a great MSG run.
Yeah,
the Colossal Jostle. Many bad MSG matches. Plenty of Colossal Jostle. The Colossal Jostle trilogy, duology. Plenty of colossaling, jostling. And he's been great. I'm actually going to kind of miss him. But, again, the roster needs to be flushed out. And, you know, there is some dead wood here. But, yeah, I gave it 2 stars. I liked it. I thought Morocco was fine. I thought Warrior looked good. And, yeah, I think Vince was intentionally kind of giving some of these guys an opportunity to have the stage to themselves to see how they can handle the big match atmosphere, particularly going into WrestleMania 4, which is going to have such a huge card with a billion guys. There's a good chance to test the waters. So, a solid enough main event.
Yeah, it's all right. All right, so there you have sad star and a half, 2 stars. A great main event. All right, so that brings us to the end of the show. So it is time for some awards. So here we go, guys. Why don't we start things off with the match of the night? I went with Bigelow DiBiase.
Same.
Yep, I agree.
Okay. The Cousin Jr. for the worst match of the night. To me, there was a few contenders, but Steele versus Sika was the worst on this evening for me.
Me as well. We already know what Tim's going to put.
Sorry, Duggan.
Trust me, Tim, I'll probably give him that. I'll give him that enough times in the future. Don't worry.
All right. So Duggan, the Ho Man, and Bravo.
One Bass.
Yes, that's right. I'm getting them all confused.
You can throw that match out there, too.
All right, Duggan Bass. All right, the Hogan Award for the MVP of the evening. I went with Bigelow. I thought he looked great in that match. He felt like the biggest face star on the show, even with the pops Duggan and Jake got. Bigelow just felt like he had the bigger star presence. I thought he did a really good job and kind of what was his first big MSG show that he's carrying on his own. So that's my choice.
I'm going to go with DiBiase. I think he, because he's the guy that may consider the heel favorite for the tournament, I think it was his chance to shine. I thought he did a fine job. I thought the match was good. I thought the post-match promo back with Craig DeGeorge was good. I think it was his chance to really kind of unencumbered have a chance to shine without Hogan or Andre there. So I'm going to go with DiBiase.
And I went DiBiase, too, though honorable mention to Bobby the Brain for his couple commentary matches that he did. I thought just putting over storylines, getting ready for Mania, I thought he did great. But I think DiBiase, the heat he got every single time he was up there was great.
All right. Bigelow doesn't clean sweep the awards like he's used to, Scott. So,
yeah, not this time. Close, though.
All right. Uncle Elmer for the biggest loser of the night, and that is George the fucking Animal Steele. He can go fuck himself. I'm so sick of George Steele. So that is my choice.
Yes, I agree.
Tim,
and I went with the unnamed ref. I mean, he was terrible. He, for 3 matches, he screwed up all 3 of them. I feel like so. I went him. But if you want to put me down for Steele, I won't complain too much.
No, I put you down. Unnamed blonde ref. That's all fair. Right. All right, best moment of the night. I went with Warrior's pin to end the show. I thought that the crowd was super into it. The way they timed it was pretty well, and it was kind of, you know, it was smart the way they did it. And I thought everyone was pretty into it. End of the show on a fired up note.
Breaks our streak of 4 straight great moments involving Andre. I'll go with the end of the match, end of the show. I thought it was pretty hot.
Yeah, it was interesting. They didn't play his music, though, when they won. You know, the Warriors' music. They just booked it out of there. I actually went when JYD came in to make the save and kind of set up that match. I think those 2 matches together were actually a pretty good. Whatever, 25 minutes, and him coming in with a massive pop, I think was probably the moment of the night, and the crowd got really into it.
All right, the Morocco Award for the juiced up juice head Guido of the night. I went Don Morocco, the namesake of the award, back in the mix after Hogan won it last time, but he's now co-won at least, or won 3 of the last 4 for me. Who do you guys got?
Yeah, he's won it, let's see, since May of 87. He's won, let's see, actually since WrestleMania 3, he's won it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times.
And he's won it once.
Shared or had it.
He won the March 86 Saturday's main event as well, so there's another one.
Yeah, so 9 of the last couple of years, and either shared or had it on his own, he should keep it going.
You agree, Tim?
Tim?
I'll give it to him, but I also thought the natural Butch Reed, given his name to the natural, he was pretty jacked from what I... compared to what I remember him. But I think he's just short, so it just makes his arms are huge. So, but give it to Don Morocco. It's his award. Keep it going.
All right. I did institute the brand new Patera Award for the worst hair. We'll give that to Ken Patera since it's his namesake here tonight. Any qualms?
Oh, not at all.
Okay.
Do we have to go back to January 85
yes.
now? And just
you need to rewatch everything, Scott. Between
well,
we
could do the missing.
Show.
We could do the missing link every time he was on.
That's right. We could probably look at the cards and just guess. Maybe we can do that at least. Look at the card and posthumously award them. But,
yes.
Anyway, going forward, we'll track the best hair or the worst hair rather.
That'll be it, he'll definitely win it on every card. I can't think of anyone even close when he's on the card.
Yeah.
There'll be some interesting ones. All right. Overall grade on this evening. Went 4 out of 10. I thought there was enough here to at least make it interesting. It wasn't the dog shit one we saw a few weeks ago from January that just had nothing. This at least had a couple of things. Sweeten or not, the crowd added to it. And there was enough going on here. But again, not a great show. There's really no big match. The best match of me topped out at 2.5. So that's not really a very good show at all. But again, there wasn't anything too bad besides the Steele match. I thought everything else just kind of fell in that 1-2 range. So 4 felt about right, Scott.
Mm. Yeah, I'll give it a 4 as well. It's definitely better than that piece of crap in January. Again, I applaud Vince for kind of thinking outside the box on this show and, you know, giving some of the big players the night off, like Andre and Hogan and Savage, and letting guys like Warrior, DiBiase, Bigelow, even Duggan kind of have the stage to themselves. So, yeah, I give it a 4 as well.
And I gave it a 5. Just the amount of missing people on it, yet it was, you know, none of the championship. No one holding a title.
Right.
You know, no Honky, no Strikeforce. But I thought it moved along pretty well, as much as you guys make fun of me for the Steele match. I thought that everything moved along pretty well and it was exciting to do and to watch. And definitely nothing compared to that last show. So I think a 5 for me.
All right. That one's in the books, gentlemen. Tim, I hope you enjoyed your maiden voyage here. It was a lot of fun having you.
That was great. Thank you, guys. I really appreciate it.
It was great to have you, Tim.
Get you back in the saddle soon for sure. Scott, we're off next week. Got some work commitments and other whatnots in the way. So we'll be back 2 weeks from tonight on Memorial Day Monday, talking the final step before WrestleMania 4. That'll be the March 88 Saturday night's main event. We'll cover that, and then we get some stuff going on from there we'll cover off on that episode. So everyone, enjoy your week off. Scott, what do you got planned? Anything going on you want to plug?
This week, we will, Brother Nate and I will have the next installment of our 10-part series on our greatest WWE Greatest 100 Superstars of All Time. Next week, on episode 102 of the main event, your man Brandon Howard will be back on with us.
Nice.
We'll talk about kind of wrap up WrestleMania fiscally with a bow and talk a little bit about this all-in show and the ticket price situation and kind of the you know, what it means to the wrestling landscape with this big show coming in September. So that'll be next week on the main event. Your main brand that'll be on.
What do I got going on? I was on.
When's the next zone coming on?
Hopefully this week we're planning on. That'll be In Your House Excellent. 3. So I'm looking forward
Great
to
show.
Talking that with Chad. Thank you.
Yeah,
so
it's been very good. Enjoyed it.
We got 3 in the books for that. I'm having a lot of fun. Chad, Campbell, and myself going through the starting with the Monday Night Wars, starting in September 95. We're doing every Raw, Nitro, and pay-per-view. So we're up to In Your House 3. And check that out, Wrestling War Zone, the Monday Night Wars podcast is the name. Please like our Facebook page, by the way. I've been excited about some of the conversation that's gone on over there. A lot of the good discussion when I do my little question of the day. So trying to keep things active. So if you haven't liked the Facebook page yet, you can reach out to me for the link. Or I think if you just search Wrestling War Zone, it's the one that should come up. So I implore you to check that show out. It's a good one. I was also on the newest Talk and Pop that dropped over the weekend with Tim and Jennifer. We talked some of the shows that got canceled. We talked some Jersey Shore. We talked summer blockbuster movies. You can hear me talk about my foray into comics. I am a Marvel Unlimited subscriber now. Been listening to the new Marvel Age podcast with Nick, Tim, Todd, and Russell. It's a great show. They are doing basically the history of Marvel year by year. Started with 61, 62. It's a great podcast. I really enjoyed it, and it got me to download the app, which I am sharing with the cowboy. He's going to use that for his nephew. So I've been following along with the reading list that the boys are using for that show. So definitely worth checking that out. And I talk about that more in depth on Talk and Pop, as well as pushing Jenny to do a wrestling podcast. So listen to all that. It was a great episode. It's on the PTN Pop feed, which I recommend you subscribe to, along with other feeds. So,
Absolutely.
Tim, anything you want to plug? Anything you got going on?
Nothing. I'm begging the cowboy to return to class. That was my WrestleMania goal.
Good luck with that.
Yeah, it's hard work, man. Hard work.
He failed.
No. but definitely enjoyed the Monday Night War so far. I don't think I've ever seen In Your House 3, so it's on the docket to watch to see how that is.
Good.
But that's been great stuff, and I started watching listen to the main events. So that's good stuff as well. And then you still got Jeff Lawrence Wrestling coming back, or is that he's given up?
No, he's not given up. We do have a plan to come back soon, hopefully in the next couple weeks. So we'll let Jeff cover off what he's been doing. The show has become more like a therapy session for him than anything else, but I think that's just as good.
It's a good laugh. Yeah. Maybe belongs on the pop feed, but wrestling feed, but it always makes me laugh.
He's got some interesting stories for sure. So we'll see what he gets into on his next one. Hopefully, maybe in the next couple weeks, we'll find some time for that. So, okay. All right. So that'll do it. Subscribe to our feeds on iTunes, Placement Nation Wrestling, Placement Nation Pop, and Pro Wrestling Only. Hit up all those. Check out all our wonderful shows, huh?
I was saying PWO. Let's finish the third one. Right?
Thank you. Appreciate it. That's why we're here together. Mm-hmm. All right, that's it. Download our free ebooks. Shop with us, placementnation.com/Amazon. Facebook, place number 2B Nation. That's Twitter. Facebook, Placement Nation. Check that out as well. So I'm out. I'm done. I'm cooked. You're out. Bye, Tim. Bye, Scott. Talk to you guys later.
See ya. Thanks again.